My name is Paul Holdengräber. I'm the director of public programs here at the New York Public Library, known as Live from the New York Public Library. It's my pleasure to welcome George Saunders back to the Live from the New York Public Library stage. It has been quite a week. Last night we had Rachel Kushner and Paul Schrader. Tomorrow, Vietta Nguyen and Arundhati Roy. On May 14th, I will speak with Nobel Prize winner Mario Vargas Llosa. On May 21st, with Jane Mayer. May 23rd, the artist Anne Hamilton will join Magnum photographer Susan May Salas. Roxane Gay will be with us on June 11th with poet Aja Monet. And on June 20th, I will speak with one of the foremost investigative journalists of our time, Seymour Hersh. Sai is coming out with his memoir simply entitled Reporter. In it, he writes, "My career has been all about the importance of telling important and unwanted truths and making America a more knowledgeable place." We have given our Live from the New York Public Library Spring 2018 closing night the hopefully fitting title of Unwanted Truths. After our conversation, George Saunders will be happy to sign books. As always, I'm grateful for the continued generosity of Celeste Barthes, Manaz, and Adam Barthes. I'm grateful to the Man Booker Prize for joining forces with us tonight, as well as Random House. From Random House, Derek Parra has been a huge support and put up with my insistence that George Saunders must come back to this stage. It's been many, many years that I've wanted this moment. From the Booker Prize, Gabby Wood has been our strongest ally. Gabby is also a former fellow of the Cullman Center here at the New York Public Library. From the Booker as well, I wish to thank Doty Irving. As you know, I've been asking my guests for many years now to give me a biography of themselves in seven words. If I could have shortened these 10 words of George Saunders, I would have. I love them. He says, "What I regret most in life are failures of kindness." But he actually did submit seven words to me. But I will, before mentioning his seven words, I will break the tradition a little bit and preempt the surprise tomorrow and mention Arundhati Roy's seven words, which are actually six words. I hope she won't mind. The hooker who won the Booker. The reason I mention this is that tonight we have three Booker Prize winners in one room. One of them is late, but he will arrive. It's Marlon James and Sir Salman Rushdie. And of course, to join me on stage in one moment, Man Booker Prize winner George Saunders, whose seven words are, "Less selfish as time passed, I hope." George Saunders.
Nice. Thank you.
Nice, no? Well, let's start with this. If we could show video two, or listen to video two.
That the object of life is self-perfection, the perfection, of one's immortal soul, that this is the only object of man's life, is seen to be correct by the fact alone that every other object is senseless in lieu of death. Therefore, the question whether thou hast done what thou shouldst have done is of immense importance, for the only meaning of thy life is in doing in this short term alone thee that which is desired of thee by him who or that which has sent thee into life. Art thou doing the right thing?
Pretty good.
Pretty good, no?
Yeah, yeah.
Do people recognize what that is? Do you want to?
I have a guess that it's,
yeah?
That it's not someone in the Trump administration. Is it Tolstoy?
It is.
Yeah, yeah. Speaking in English.
Incredible.
Yeah,
no?
Beautiful.
What did this inspire?
Well,
you know, you mentioned this last time you were at the library.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I as kind of a simple person, I don't. I had a late start in Indian intellectual life. This idea is the one I keep coming back to, which is I don't really, as I get older, care about much except not being a fuck up morally. Really, you know, like I don't really have enough of a deep well of intellectual or literary knowledge to run on that fuel. But when I turn my mind to the reality that time is short and I haven't gotten it right yet, then a bunch of energy comes up. And and Tolstoy was an early influence for just that reason, because you felt that he kind of hated literature, actually. He kept
hated
trying to quit.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then when he became, when a feeling of moral urgency welled up in him, he would turn to literature and work with it. So he had, I think, a very nice attitude about it. It wasn't a hobby. It wasn't necessarily a sort of a demonstrative thing. It was a necessary thing that he used to work through moral choices, I suppose. You know.
But you don't have that. I mean, you don't hate literature.
No, I don't hate it, but I feel outgunned by it. You know, I literally don't. I just don't have a deep well. I've been trying to catch up with reading all my life. I was an engineer, and so I don't. I love it, but I feel, when I'm being honest, I feel that it's too much for me. That, in other words, I think there are some writers who are so intelligent and well-read and well-educated that they can sort of come in through the front door of literature. I want to do this.
But not being, I mean, you said it yourself, not being educated in some way has afforded you something.
It lets you come in through the basement, you know?
And so the entrance is quite different.
It's very, you have to crawl, you have to go at night, you have to be a little ashamed, you know? But I realized this actually very early. I was late getting a first book out. I was 38 when my first book came out, and I had sort of tried to come in through the front door, and I kept getting subtly turned away by. I don't know who that asshole was, but somebody was. You know, now there was no originality. It was because I didn't have the chops. It was sort of imitative. It had a lot. I thought that one had to know exactly what you were trying to say and just say it.
And did you find that was not the case?
It wasn't the case, and there was a catastrophic day when I'd written a 700-page book in that spirit that didn't work, and then at work as a tech writer the next day, I just wrote these poems that were funny and kind of scatological and a little filthy, you know, but they were funny, and so something popped for me, and I thought, okay, I'll go around and go through the basement.
Do you remember any of those poems?
No, I have them, but I don't remember them. I try to forget them. But they were just Dr. Seuss, literally written out of the corner of my eye, whereas before I had been writing very conceptually with a lot of control, condescendingly, actually. My vision at that time was the reader could sit here while I kind of pulled up this manure truck full of my ideas and, you know, gifted her with them. And this was much more desperate. It was more, I grew up in the South Side of Chicago, and one of the ways we performed was comic sketches, imitation, sort of staccato, like George Carlin, Richard Pryor type of things. This
George Carlin is so extraordinary. I've done very few tributes at the library, but we did one tribute for him with a number of comedians, Ben Stiller and his family, and Louis C.K. and all kinds of other people. But the best moment was his daughter saying that her father had never been happier than when the Supreme Court justices had to repeat the seven words you can't. Isn't that fantastic?
That would make you happy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But George Carlin, why?
I felt the class on him, the working class. You feel that moment when he decides to lurch towards the truth and away from the accepted forms, and you get that little jolt when that's been done. Oh yeah, that I thought that too, you know that. And then the other, he kind of somehow led me to Monty Python, which is another big influence for the same reason, that the freshness of an idea that comes right from the street or from the world.
Can we look at video number one, just because I like it?
I hope it's the whole film of the Holy Grail. That would get me off the hook here.
And here come the Germans now, led by their skipper, Nobby Hagel. They must surely start favorites this afternoon. They've certainly attracted the most attention from the press with their team problems. And let's now see their lineup. The Germans playing 4-2-4, Leibniz in goal, back four, Kant, Hegel, Schopenhauer, and Schelling, front runners Schlegel, Wittgenstein, Nietzsche, and Heidegger, and the midfield duo of Beckenbauer and Jaspers. Beckenbauer, obviously a bit of a surprise there. And here come the Greeks, led out by their veteran centre-half, Heraclitus. Let's look at their team. As you'd expect, it's a much more defensive lineup. Plato's in goal, Socrates a front runner there, and Aristotle as sweeper. Aristotle, very much the man in form. One surprise is the inclusion of Archimedes. Well, here comes the referee, Kung Fu Tzu, Confucius, and his two linesmen, St. Augustine and St. Thomas Aquinas. And as the two skippers come together to shake hands, we're ready for the start of this very exciting final. The referee, Mr. Confucius, checks his sand, and they're off. Nietzsche and Hegel there. Carl Jaspers, number 7 on the outside. Wittgenstein there with him. There's Beckenbauer. Schelling's in there, Heidegger covering, Schopenhauer, and now it's the Greek.
So,
Epicurus,
I mean,
we
could obviously watch all of it, and maybe we should
Let's take a vote.
Yeah, take a vote. Who wants to see more? A bit more? You watched... You watched a lot of Monty Python. You watched it with your father also.
Yeah, and we watched it with... no one knew what it was. It just came on every Sunday, and we'd sit there. And I remember at one point my father laughing so hard that he slid off the couch. And that... I was looking for power in the world, and that was powerful, you know, to see one's father dissolve in laughter. So I think...
And very movingly, you speak about your father as a genius. And I'm curious... what in your eyes made him a genius, and what that term?
Well, he's a great storyteller. He came from the South Side of Chicago, didn't go to college. His early job was as a collection agent for household finance. So literally, as a 22-year-old, he would have to burst into people's houses and say, "Give me the TV," and they were often apparently not happy to do that, you know. And so I think he did a lot of backpedaling and fast talking and so on. But he was somebody who. From my point of view, he was someone who was educating himself in really unconventional ways. So I'd come home and my mom would say, "Your dad wants you to read this," and it would be Machiavelli. Or it'd be Michael Harrington, The Other Side of America. You know, and I think he came across these books he was a coal salesman actually in Chicago. And I think he would just roam around, meet interesting, intense South Side people right out of Saul Bellow. And they would say, "You got to read this Machiavelli. He's fucking unbelievable." You know, and then he would grab it and read it and give it to me. So it was...
And you would?
I would. Oh, yeah, because I loved him and admired him. And I was kind of looking for anything that came from him. And it was interesting to try to piece that all together. What did it mean? And the books were always vital. They weren't the most popular or current book. It was just a book that somehow had found its way to him through a path of vitality, and he had judged it vital and passed it on. So you're sort of trying to read the coded message behind the selection of books, you know. So and then, you know, he had a chicken franchise in Chicago called Chicken Unlimited, and with the very Zen motto, "Chicken Unlimited doesn't stop at chicken." You know, So I was his delivery boy, and we worked together, my parents, my sisters, all my high school friends. And it was really something to be in proximity to your father and watch how he worked, watch how he dealt with customers. And it was just a really wonderful thing. So, yeah.
How old were you when you read Machiavelli?
Probably 13, 12, or something. I mean, I thought he lived in Chicago. I didn't know. Yeah.
You know, it does bring back a moment I had here when I interviewed Mike Tyson. And I was told that he loved Machiavelli. And we have a first edition of The Prince, and he came in and he said, as we showed him this edition, he said, "I think there's an early edition." And there was, in the Vatican. Right. And I remember being on stage and saying to him, "You know, I'm so amazed how immersed you were in the special collections, which we did just before coming on stage tonight." And he said, "You know, a room without books is like a body without a soul." And I was amazed. Yeah. You know, this was an extraordinary. And the next day, someone from The Guardian called, who was reviewing the event, and said, "You know, that sentence you were so amazed by was by Cicero." And I said, "But that's, you know," I was thinking that maybe he was trying to put down Mike Tyson. I said, "That's fantastic.
Yeah, even
that's
better.
Mike Tyson quoting Cicero in context."
Yeah, right. Well, you know, I there's something that happened when I first came to Syracuse that I'm still thinking about all these years later. I was in Amarillo at that time, working as a gardener, basically, and playing guitar in a band. Lots of hardship going on in my family and our extended group of friends, and addiction and all kinds of stuff. So I came east for the first time, and I thought I was going to be greeted a little bit like Neil Cassidy, you know, somebody who was very authentic and knew some things about flyover country. And at one late night breakfast, I was trying to talk about this period in my life that was about a 4-year, really intense, destructive, kind of depressing time. And my classmates, who were from better schools and a higher social thing, I know them and love them, but they were kind of just joking about it. "Oh, Amarillo, that's the place where the currency exchanges are. Ha, 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 ha." And I'd say, "Yes, but..." And I kept trying to kind of communicate that real human lives are being lived there, and it never quite took. And I left there really bitter. I mean, that was 30, 40 years ago, so you can see. But there was something about that, you know,
the
idea that we, you know, culture comes from a certain place, and it has to. And it has to be codified, and in some ways it has to come from above. But people who come in that basement are like Tyson, you know, we are inspired by something very visceral and essential to learn this stuff that is gonna help us stop being full of shit. Because in that world, the ignorance that is often, you know, cloaked in merriment or whatever, it's very aggressive and very dangerous. And I think when you're in that, you can sort of say, "Well, I have to somehow get out of this." And every so often, you're lucky enough to say, "Oh, the way out is up," and then you start sort of following the trail. You know?
What was extraordinary about that night is I had invited 100 boxers to come. I had called up boxing clubs and said, "You know, bring me your best." Mm-hmm. And they heard this story, and they got in touch with me afterwards, after the event, and said, "Can I see some of the special collections? Mm-hmm. Can I come back to the library?" And they then came. They came with children, and they felt a sense of empowerment from having heard him speak about this, that it mattered to him.
Yeah, I think intensity respects intensity. You know, I worked at a slaughterhouse for a while, and you could see that. You know, mostly I was suppressing any trace of intelligence because I didn't want to get beat up. But every so often, I would say something from the heart, and you could see that the coworkers would kind of go, "Huh, what do you mean by that?" You know, at that time, I'd been to Asia and back, so I could drop that every now and then and say, "What do you mean? What's it like in Asia?" You know, so I think when someone is in intense circumstance, they know bullshit when they see it, they know truth when they see it, and they do, you know, seek out truth, I think. Not always, obviously, but...
I want to stay on the subject of class. Mm-hmm. You speak about lower class writers. And you say in an essay about Mark Twain, "Like many lower class writers, Chekhov, Dickens, Gogol come to mind, Twain started his career being purely funny in comic sketches that were mostly dirt and very little people mover. And all his writing life struggled with the question of what his apparent narrative rationale should be, which is why he left behind such a long trail of abandoned manuscripts. Now, I'm interested in this grouping of lower class writers, and Twain, Dickens, Chekhov, Gogol, and if you see yourself in that lineage.
Well, yes, but way below.
In the base.
Yeah. And a lower class, that's probably, I wouldn't probably use that exact phrase now because it's something else. Maybe working class, but I do. Only because again, you come to the front door, and I think Gogol actually, Pevjarn Volokhonsky translation of Dead Souls, there's a beautiful introduction, and they say that Gogol basically came, met Pushkin, and went, "Oh, forget about it. I can't compete with this guy on those rules." And that's when he started writing in dialect and kind of doing sort of Ukrainian things. And essentially, he was doing a sort of a form of corporatese. You know, he was taking the strange dialects and the working class malapropisms and folding them into his narrative. So I think,
wouldn't use that term anymore. Why?
It sounds judgy, you know. I mean, I would say working class, but I don't know that that's really quite accurate, you know. But
does it sound unkind?
A little bit, yeah. Because I don't know that Twain. I don't think lower class. I don't think that's quite it. So I'm not sure what term I would use now. But to me, the reason I identified with that group of writers is that you can feel in all of their work at some critical moment. Someone takes the gloves off and says, I can't use an unnatural diction. I can't do literature by reaching up and standing on my tiptoes. I have to be flat-footed and authentic to myself. For me, that moment just meant that I could allow in all the voices that I could do naturally, comedically. And the light went on. I thought, oh, of course, that is the source of literature. If I can do a South Side of Chicago working guy who's really irritated, which I can, then of course it's a human being. Of course you can use that as the place for the voice to be made, and then you hope to do that the poetry, which means overflow the diction into something universal. But for me to go the other way and say, let me try to be a very well-educated housewife in Stamford, Connecticut, I just don't have that voice. I don't have it. So for me, the big breakthrough was to go, okay, I mean, my mantra might be use what you got, which at the age of 25 or 26 is bitter, because I didn't want to use what I had. I wanted to have something else, a better vocabulary, a more comprehensive knowledge of world literature. But not having it, and in that particular moment when we had two kids and we were kind of struggling with money, it was kind of this sad but delicious feeling of, okay, I can only use what's natural to me, and I'm going to have to try to make what's natural to me be transcendent, you know. That was the idea, anyway. I don't know.
while reporting for a story in Dubai, you wrote a note to yourself that said, "Poor city equals rage."
Yeah.
I want you to unpack that a little bit.
Well, I think our culture is violent, and it's kind of a denial-based culture, and it plays very rigorously by the rules of capitalism. So if you, in our country, find yourself without very much money, you won't find a graceful cultural way for you to explain you to yourself. Except, you're a loser. You must have fucked up, you know. So I never experienced that as a kid, but in my 20s, I kind of went down the rabbit hole a little bit. And there were just a few relatively minor moments, but they stick with you, where you see that in our culture, when you come up wanting, the culture actually doesn't like you. And it is happy to crush you. That's
And you're one step away from being homeless.
No, I wasn't that, because I have parents that would too.
No, but it's something you can feel.
Exactly.
You know, it doesn't take much.
It doesn't take much, and people will turn away from you politely because there's something unseemly about being needy in our world. I was up in Canada and after the election, and I was talking to people about what's wrong with America. And you ask Canadians that, and they first go, "Oh, nothing. You know, it's fine. You know, yeah. Sorry. But one driver said, "Well, I'd rather not say." I said, "No, come on." He said, "Well, you're arrogant." He said, "You know, Canadians try to find out, but Americans always know." I said, "Yeah." So the next night, I relayed that to a woman at the bookstore, and she said, yeah. She goes, "But you know what I think is a more truthful answer? You don't have a safety net. So if an American falls, she falls all the way, you know?" So that makes a kind of a fear for any of us. And I was a doorman in Beverly Hills for a while, and you never saw more fear than in the people that have it. Because they know. They know that what's keeping them from falling is the stuff that they have. So I think that, I'm making it sound depressing, and I don't...
I don't think so.
No.
I mean, there's nothing, it's not depressing, it's very real.
Yeah.
Or maybe it's depressing because it's so real.
Yeah. I think it explains a lot of things, and it also, in the spirit of Tolstoy, when I have been thinking about life over these years, that fundamental fact is always in the front of my conception. And then the question, how should we try to alter that circumstance, and how should we live in the face of it? I always trot out this Terry Eagleton quote, but it's so beautiful. Capitalism plunders the sensuality of the body. That's true, isn't it? You know, and hopefully we get...
Say it again.
Capitalism plunders the sensuality of the body. So hopefully we get through our life without that. We can sort of put a life in place that lets us forget that. But you go out on the street and it's evident, it's evident everywhere. So that has to be factored into our joy as well. You know, in the moments when you're having happiness, I try to just remember that it's conditional. It's, very, very conditional.
I want to turn to Vonnegut. You once wrote that humor is what happens when you're told the truth quicker and more directly than we're used to. And Vonnegut, in his memoir, Man Without a Country, wrote, "I used to laugh my head off at Laurel and Hardy. There's a terrible tragedy there somehow. These men are too sweet to survive in this world, and are in a terrible danger all the time. They could be killed so easily."
Yeah.
It's great, huh?
Yeah. I think for me, the humor is, somehow it's the moment when you realize that all of the systems of control that you've built up are not gonna save you, you think of all the things that could happen in your life, and you think of the way that, at least the way that I tell myself the story of myself so as to feel in control of things. And then you fall down the steps, or you fart at a funeral or something. And those are the light things that can happen. But I think my experience of life has been, I'm always going from day to day hoping that nothing horrible will happen. But everywhere you look, there's scattered evidence that it's happening all the time. So that's an incredibly precarious position. And especially when I think the idea that we construct ourselves, or maybe we are constructed so as to think we're central to the universe. This is a story that's happening in my book. Thanks for showing up. We're permanent, All those other suckers will die, but luckily not me. And there's another one that we do. But this idea of ourselves as being in control, permanent, is obviously not true. And we know it's not true. But comedy is when the world lightly reminds us that it's so, I think. So often, you hear people say, "Oh, comedy, yeah, that's kind of fun. Why did you decide to be a comic writer?" But to me, it's so intrinsic to my view of life that I think, if I wrote a story without comedy, it would be a very false story, because the noble coexists with the terrible, and the juxtaposition is comic. And if you left one out, you'd be lying, I think,
It was interesting, in the collection tour we had, the curator separated that what was really tragic from what was comic. There was one side that was serious and one side that was not.
Yeah.
And your reaction to that when she showed you that, he said, I'll walk in the middle.
Yeah. Or maybe I'll stand in the middle and spin around really fast. You know that, yeah. Because I think we make the distinction between the tragedy and the comic to make life easier for ourselves. I remember when I was young, someone that I knew and loved had passed away too young. And we went to the funeral, and it was the worst. It was just, you know, no one could believe it had happened, and it was just, and this was in Texas, and we walked out of the church, and across the street was a strip mall. And there was a Chuck E. Cheese in the strip mall, this, you know, theme restaurant. And in my memory, I may have enhanced this, but in my memory, the guy who plays Chuck E. Cheese, the rat, came out and took his head off and had a cigarette. You know, that happened, you know. So to me, that juxtaposition feels really truthful, and it also feels preparatory for us. You know, I guess we all live in some kind of idea that we'll live nobly, make very few mistakes, and then die with painlessly. Well, it's probably not true. So any attempt we make to live a joyful life should have that factored into it. Now, I haven't been able to figure it out yet, but I think what most of us do is you try to live a joyful life while intensely denying the, you know, the tragedy and the conditionality. But I've met a few people in my life who really seem to be able to have both of the things going on at once and live joyfully in the face of these things. And I think for me, writing is a really good way to practice that, like a scale model. Because again, if you have a story that's all cheerful puppy dogs riding on rainbows, let me write that down. But if you have that, at some point the reader goes, that's nonsense. And then you have to titrate in the other stuff. So I think a beautifully made book is kind of an organic system of reminding yourself of this sort of...
Who are the examples of those who managed to live?
Well, most of them in my life were people who were Buddhist lamas. You know, people who are very high practitioners in the Buddhism. And I've been lucky to meet a few extraordinary people who were, I can't even describe the way that they lived, but you could see that they were, they'd practiced for many, many years to be in that state, you know. So the thing is, for me, that means it's possible. It's not, our limited understanding is what makes us pull back when we go, tragedy, oh. But I think there's a beautiful story about a Buddhist monk who was on a plane reading a text, and the plane hit some turbulence so much that the seam in the plane ripped and water started coming in on his book. And he picked up an umbrella and kept reading, you know. So that's the goal, I guess.
It's funny because you mention pinchen in that way. You say that there's a Buddhist quality to pinchen. And I know pinchen matters tremendously to you. Mm-hmm. And so this notion of all-inclusiveness in pinchen.
Yeah.
And what is it about pinchen that it's... I mean, he mattered to you from very early on.
Yeah. I think with writers like pinchen, and if I don't... Mr. Rushdie, if you don't mind me embarrassing you a bit, when a person has... beautiful standards of language and structure, then I think that, I feel that urges the person toward that kind of capaciousness. In other words, if you have a very high standard for language, form, structure, then the system of contradiction is going to be built automatically to taste. You can't stand the falseness of not having the contradiction present. So this is, I mean, in this life, I'm called upon to sometimes opine publicly, but I don't really trust that very much. But I do trust the moment at my desk when something bigger than this guy is seasoning to taste. And one of the reasons I'm really addicted to writing is I can feel that with each book, my taste is getting better, which means my
view... What does that mean?
It's less on autopilot. I don't really know what I like anymore, but I know it when I see it. And I can feel my subconscious guiding me toward it, and in not only in the selection of topics, but in the day-to-day progress. And I can feel that somehow the subconscious, or whatever that force is quickly trying to move me along this track.
You speak about the subconscious, but you also speak about the sublingual.
I probably did
yeah.
throw that out once.
Yeah. What does it yeah. mean?
What it means for me, and I think yeah. I do that just so it'll sound more fancy, you know, but
right.
but I this moment of discovery that we talked about earlier, when I really first started writing for real, there was a change where the analytical conceptual part of me threw up its hand and gave, you know, walked off, and something else substituted. And that thing is something like what takes over when you're improvising in music or when you're improvising in comedy. It's just a quick, I mean, instantaneous judgment that arises out of I don't know where. And I that is the whole thing I've come to believe about my writing, anyway, is that the less conceptual baggage there is, the less intentionality, overt intentionality, the better. And everything that I like in my work, like the politics and the ethos and the themes and all that, that will come automatically if I just concentrate in this intuitive way on the line-to-line progress. It's such a nothing, you can't even describe it. But what it
but
means
try
is,
to. Try to describe it.
Well, I mean, the best way I've come up to describe it is I'm reading what I read yesterday. I'm trying to forget that I wrote it. Just, I don't know, somebody left this here. Reading it like a first-time reader and having a little meter in my head with positive over here, negative here, and then, in a sense, stepping out of the possessive nature of the person who wrote it to watch the reading mind of that person. Where is the needle? If the needle's in the positive, we're good. Nothing needs to be said. But, of course, it dips. And when it dips, there's, for me, a critical moment when I don't try to figure out why. I just try to fix it, like a little lurch, a cut of a phrase or something like that. It's completely intuitive. And for me, the better it's going, the less this person is present and there's some other... I mean, it's almost like when you play tennis, you're not saying, okay, right arm, 47 degrees, and let's go. You're just acting, and for me, that's the impulse that takes over when I'm writing well. And the sort of adjustment I've had to make over the years is to go, yeah, for you, dummy, that's it. And although I'm, you know, you're called upon to make a more rigorous explanation, there really isn't one. I can make it up. But for me, the idea of getting into that state day after day after day, inflicting it on the same text over and over and over, up to thousands of times, then the text micro-adjusts, and as it micro-adjusts, it starts to give off different kinds of light, which then...
Was it harder to do for Lincoln and Bardo?
No, that same. The only thing was there I had to learn to apply that intuitive sense to big structural things, you know, which section goes next, but it's the same mind, you know.
Is it in Lincoln and Bardo, was it more a collage that you managed to
yes.
do?
And so a lot of it was to say, I'm going to slightly take the attention off the language and put it on the structural progress. So give myself a little bit of a pass to be slightly less original with the language, but to then change the focus over to how the sections juxtapose against each other. That's what I was doing. Yeah.
I mentioned to you this to you when we spoke on the phone yesterday. Rebecca Solnit wrote this essay, which I think was published originally in The Guardian, where she says, call climate change what it is, violence. And she writes, the revolt against brutality begins with a revolt against the language that hides that brutality. Mm. Mm.
Yeah.
I'm wondering what that, I feel there's a kindredness with
yeah. Well, that also makes me think of Wendell Berry, who has the same idea. You know, we're violent against the land. You know, that's a beautiful idea. What I've been thinking about lately is that as a lifelong progressive, you know, left of Gandhi, I think we do the same thing when we talk about things like, you know, the right, and I got in touch with them a little through the Trump story. The right loves it when they can say that the left is about identity politics. That's like catnip to them. I think we participate in that a little bit when we say, for example, the word diversity. Now, that's if you're the person of color, and someone says, "Oh, I'm glad you're here. We're so diverse now." Wait, no, that's actually not right. There's something sort of subtly condescending in that. I my feeling is, and I can't articulate this because I haven't tried to write it yet, but my sense is that the progressive movement is at a place where we have to go quickly to the higher ground. The higher ground is diversity, or whatever you want to call this, equality, is something that is a deeply spiritual fundamental that any sane person with a good heart will arrive at through maybe their spiritual tradition, maybe through a humanist tradition. But it's not actually a political, it is, the politics of it is a subset, but its grandest notion is spiritual. As a Buddhist, we believe that every being has Buddha nature, and that all this personality stuff and everything else is sort of obstructions that get laid in on top of it. The goal is to try to see every person as a manifestation of the Buddha. If you do that, there won't be a shred of prejudice in your body. You'll always know how to be righteous. So my take on it, in short, is that somewhere around the time of my childhood, we, for example, abandoned Catholicism because Catholicism was oppressive, which it was, in that form. What did we replace it with? You know, materialism, corporatism, pragmatism. So in my life, the process has been to try to go through that and then say, okay, but I don't really believe in materialism. Is there something higher that we can replace it with?
You loved going to the Sears store with your mother.
That I liked. The Sears store, yeah.
Yeah. You loved seeing all those commodities there.
Yeah, I don't know what I liked about Sears, but I know I used to put off by myself. This is totally embarrassing, but since I'm dreaming this, it doesn't matter. I used to go, you know, they'd have those three-way mirrors with that, and I'd go there and practice my batting stance for, you know. So, yeah.
But it was also it was kind of the sex appeal of the inanimate. You were attracted to all the stuff there.
Yeah. I'm only now realizing this is strange, but I love the sort of thousands of American dioramas that are everywhere, you know. Like up in Albany, there's a mall that we go to, and I will walk the dogs while my wife goes in. And there are just these beautiful, ugly, sublime little berms, you know, like covered with cigarettes, one little tree that's dying. And I go, who put that there? It's beautiful, you know. And I noticed it particularly because since the Lincoln book, those things aren't as beautiful to me. I got off into 1862 for a while, and now I'm trying to rev up my love for America. But I think
your love for
American ugliness and beauty, the whole thing, you know. Just the fact that imagine if you could drop into Tolstoy's Moscow and just see the way a street corner looked. It's so, you know, amazing. And so we have that opportunity here to see what detritus our culture has made, and especially in your relation to it, to say, okay, is that berm beautiful? No. Is it ugly? Yeah. But I remember Robert Stone once wrote an essay. He was offshore when the ship he was on was bombarding Vietnam, and they were firing back, and it was just incredible display. And he said he didn't think he could call it beautiful, because people were dying, obviously. But he said, still, it was something, and he used the word sublime. So I think part of what my particular mission, for some reason, is to go everywhere that I can in America, or anywhere.
Anywhere, yeah.
Yeah, and look at it, yeah. And go, okay, where is the sublime nature of this? Mainly because it is, you know, it exists. And so if I find it ugly, that's not about it. It's about the mind that's perceiving it. So I see that as another kind of lifelong struggle is to eliminate judgment in that sense, be able to, you know, this in the 60s parlance, to dig something, you know, to get in front of something ugly and go, okay, I can abide here longer than I thought. I can take it in. I can try to understand it. I think that's part of what I'm doing when I'm writing, is that.
We had a shared moment this week, which we didn't even know we had. Both of us on Monday went to see Tosca at the Metropolitan Opera. Mm. And when we spoke, we discovered that we had this moment. And we both were able to say, well, maybe I first said to you, the end of the second act is so incredible. And you said, yes, wasn't that amazing, that moment? Mm. And we could identify that moment. And your reaction right after, do you remember? You said, I'm so interested in what happened there, because I think of it very often when I think about what's happening in politics, the charisma that happens in a crowd, the fact that everybody can feel something at the same moment, what's happening now in the with our current president, what's happening in that atmosphere. So I'd love you to take us from those two sublime moments, as it were. Well, the Tosca moment, which brought you back also to your initial discovery of opera when you went to Moscow, you discovered it late, to the interest you have in a charismatic moment that all of us share, and partly that it's because there's such a crowd, it feels even more intense.
Yeah. Well, when I was in the oil business back in my 20s, we would work for 4 weeks on and get 2 weeks off. So the 2 weeks off, you could go anywhere in the world. And I went to Russia, and this was in 1981 or something, so it was still the Soviet Union. And somehow I was a real dope, but I like a kind of a moth with good instincts. I was like, I should go to the opera. That would be cool. I've never been to an opera. So I went, and the embarrassing sidebar was that I had come from Asia, so I didn't have any clothes, except I had these white farmer bib overalls, which were kind of cool in those days, especially if you didn't wear a shirt under it. But I did at least wear a shirt under it, and that was good. But so I went kind of very sweetly to the opera in this white bib overall, and I loved it. It was amazing. And in the intermission, this older Russian guy came up and just started barking at me right in my face. And his wife was trying to pull him off. And I think what he was saying was, "You American pig, why did you come dressed like that?" You know, or maybe he was asking if he could borrow it. I don't know. But so that was huge. And I don't know really what drew me to it. But I when I'm in theater, and especially the other night, it's not exactly inspiration, but it's aspiration. Like I think, oh yeah, that all these people are here to be moved. I would love to be the one moving them somehow. Or it's sort of like an objective, just like this. It's an objective reminder that the life of the mind is actually not negotiable. It's essential. And then that moment, the woman hit a certain note.
Amazing.
And I think we both described it the same way. Suddenly, that it wasn't a person singing. The whole room was reverberating, and it sounded like there was about 15 people singing at once. And then the beautiful completion of that was that when she was done, the room went insane for about 3 or 4 minutes of applause. But
did that worry you? Do those moments worry you also when a room goes wild?
No, that moment didn't.
No.
At the Trump rallies,
it worried me.
Yeah. No, because I went to I covered it for The New Yorker, and the first one I went to was in Phoenix. And it was like a Jimmy Buffett concert, you know? Just like, except nobody was stoned
Enlighten me.
Huh?
Enlighten me what that means.
Well, it was basically just a bunch of older white people hanging out being nice, you know? It was nothing. And I would always say, "Hi, I'm George, I'm a liberal, left of Gandhi," and it was fine. We had a lot of good-natured talks and nothing. Then Trump arrived, started talking, and you could feel this electric negative current energize the crowd. And I thought, wow, this is weird what's going on here. And they're doing the chanting and that whole thing. And I turned around my eye fell on this one guy who I'd seen before. He's kind of a muscular guy in black shirt, black jeans, baseball hat. And he'd been just walking around. And he was in this prayerful posture that you would see at a evangelical meeting, shaking like this, you know, with what Trump was saying. And I thought, wow, that's really interesting. And everybody was suddenly not the person they had been a couple of minutes before. And when I went out, there had been all kinds of violence on the periphery that had coincided with that moment of electric. So the other day I read something, maybe in the Times, but it said that studies have shown that in crowds, in front of charismatic speakers, the brain chemistry of everybody in the room becomes homogeneous. In other words, you're less alike than you were when you came in, and more of the same. Now, I think that happened in a positive way at the Met the other night. But it's something to think about, because we, especially when you factor in, that I think the same thing happens on social media. You know, that world really is literally virtual, in that it's just people in a strange little manufactured room revving each other up. And I'm sure that something happens to your brain on Twitter, you know, that isn't very good. And I've seen it. And after that Trump piece, I got a lot of correspondence from people. And the whole, doesn't matter how hostile they were, as soon as I would force them to engage on a human level, the whole diction of the discourse would change. And suddenly it was people. So anyway, yeah, I think there's a lot to be learned right now. I'll put it that way. You're speechless.
No, I'm just wondering, when you say there's a lot to be learned, I want to take you up on that and and say, what in particular?
Well, I have a lot of people in my extended sphere of influence, family and friends, who are Trump supporters. And I have been studying them and talking to them and while continuing to love them and so on. I'll give one angle. I think there needs to be a changing of the conceptual axis in the way that the public discourse is held. We're held in the thrall of a left-right divide that is very profitable for certain people. In other words, what we call liberal and conservative, even 10 years ago, was not really as rigid. Well, there's a lot of people making a lot of money for riding that horse into the ground. It's not to say that the difference isn't real. The difference has never been more real, but it's being reinforced by these corporate media mouthpieces, essentially. It seems to me that if we could somehow change that axis a little bit, and this is one I mentioned earlier, we have some pretty good principles in this country that are quite simple and quite difficult to achieve. I think if we could change the public discourse to prioritize those things, we might get back to a saner place where we could actually talk to one another. Now, having tried it at those rallies, it's not going to work because I couldn't have been any nicer or had any better conversations, but I don't think I changed a single mind, which is a little scary. But I think if we, to me, again, I would go back to Buddhism. In a Buddhist frame of thought, or actually, yeah, even as a writer, in a literary state of mind, connection is the whole goal. And if we continue to polarize the camps into left and right and just heap abuse on one another, that is a very scary downward spiral. So I don't really know the answer, but for me, writing right now is very important because you can, with writing, you take a monolithic identity, Trump supporter, and you go, that doesn't produce any good language, Trump supporter. Let me start with Mel. Okay, Mel. Let Mel walk into a room and start talking. The demands of the form are going to force you to be attentive and specific in describing Mel.
So describe Mel.
Mel is an asshole.
Okay. I see the headline tomorrow for this evening.
No, it's just Mel. We just made him up. He's not. All right, but I don't like that. I don't like it as a sentence. I don't like it as a stance. So we say, okay, and we invoke the eternal, the writing gods, and they say,
why do you say that?
Well, he's just an asshole. How so? Mel berated the young barista.
Why do you think he did that?
Mel berated the young barista who reminded him of his dead wife. So we've gone from Mel, that asshole, to Mel, who is so heartsick that he can't behave well in front of a young woman. That's more interesting. I would say it's more interesting on the sentence level. And suddenly our relation to Mel is different, That's powerful, If you say, how do you work with an asshole? Hurt him. That's, how do you work with someone who's so heartsick? Then suddenly certain of our capabilities rise to that moment, I think, So I think that's always been one of the functions of fiction, is to break down a monolithic conceptual statement into component statements that are somehow more understandable to us and towards which our sympathy might go out. Now, the catch of this, I think, is that if you apply these principles to a sociopath, you're getting into false territory. You can generate a kind of a idiot compassion that is not actually truthful.
An idiot compassion.
Yeah. I think that has a Buddhist term, but it basically means, somebody hits you in the head with a rock and you say, oh, thanks for the geology lesson. So this is, I think, one of the things that when I was touring for Lincoln, a lot of really wonderful young people would say, should we resist or be compassionate? I think it's the same. I don't think there's actually a difference when you work through it. If you're understanding somebody in a way that enables them to do evil things, you're not actually understanding them, you know. So I think that's what compassion, and again, I always come back to writing, but I think compassion, empathy, all those ideas, sometimes they seem a little pink and purple with balloons coming off them. I believe in kindness, you know.
But who doesn't, right? Who doesn't?
Oh, right.
Right, I mean,
exactly.
So kindness spoken about in that way is a weak quality when it isn't.
And it's also something that you grant to somebody. But I think if we look at the world intelligently, kindness and empathy and compassion, those are natural byproducts. They're scientific byproducts of our condition on Earth, you know. Given the fact that anything could happen to anybody at any time, given the fact that we're so limited in our ability to love, given the fact that we're incredibly vulnerable, all these things, given the fact that our egos and our sense of being separate people is actually delusional, you know, it's something that your body creates for Darwinian reasons. Given all those things, I think what that spits out is that kindness is the only non-delusional response to our situation here. It's not a gift that we grant because we're happy. It's almost like if someone said, oh, I don't really, I consent to gravity. No, you don't, you know. If you think at all, if you're at all intelligent, you'll see that gravity is a fact of life. Kindness, and there's got to be a better word for it, but kindness, I think, will be your conclusion, be the conclusion to any rigorous examination of our condition here. To be not kind is to be delusional based on what our actual situation is. Now, that doesn't mean we still have to train ourselves in it. I mean, it's impossible. You know, it seems impossible. But I think that's, you know, yeah. That's what I think.
I love this line you quote of F. Scott Fitzgerald on Mark Twain. I'd love you to expand on it. You say, his eyes were the first eyes that ever looked at us objectively, that were no eyes from overseas.
Hmm. Yeah, yeah. Well, I think that's probably, for me, what that makes me think is received wisdom versus authentic wisdom. So for me, when I was first writing, I had this Hemingway thing going on that if I ever want to get a cheap laugh, I just say I had a Hemingway boner. Yeah. But I loved him. I didn't really.
It didn't work tonight.
It not so much. I think I maybe used it too many times. But the idea that you have a few masters in mind, you receive their writing, and you try to imitate it. And I think what Twain was able to do was to step out of that and find a language that was in direct relation to reality rather than to previous literature. That I think is really difficult, you know, to look at this room and describe it afresh without referring to something that came before us, you know. And I think especially in his time, you know, the country was new, and anyone who was cultured was expected to kowtow to Europe. And Twain, not only did he go into situations and places that were unseemly, but he knew that the vernacular was actually the only way to do justice to those things. You know, if somebody from Europe had come into some of his settings, say he came into Huck Finn's house, the stance would be to make sure that we knew how low this was, and to express it in a high language that had a great range. And I think Twain and Gogol, you know, these kind of writers, they understand that in order to really describe something, there's an adjustment of syntax required. To use an elevated syntax is actually a form of condescension that the reader picks up on. So to pick up, and you know, for me it was working in a corporation and trying to describe the corporation with literary language was falsifying somehow. But to say, okay, I am of the corporation, I'm going to use corporatese, you know, our quarterly goals in terms of what we hope to achieve are going to be, we hope, bypassed by what we actually do accomplish. Suddenly you're in that conference room in a way that you wouldn't be if you stayed above it. So Twain was my model for that, for sure.
As a way to speak a little bit about Lincoln and the Bardo, I want us to listen to this audio clip number one.
I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That would. I'm not sure if this is why you chose it, but I heard this story about Lincoln many years, 20 years ago.
Yeah, I know it's a story that started with you a long, 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 long time ago.
Yeah. Just hearing the story that Lincoln had gone into the crypt to hold his son's body, and I put off. I thought, that's for someone else to write. It's too. It's not my thing. And then it was.
How wrong you were.
Well, yeah. I hope, but it pretty much died out, and I was driving through the Berkshires, and I was listening to, I think, that piece of glasses, and somehow this spontaneous, just a spontaneous vision of a stage.
Why?
I don't know. I really don't know. I just saw the stage. I saw the crypt, a mass grave, and a few other graves of the main characters,
This triggered it. This triggered for you.
Yeah, it came up spontaneously, and I just was excited about it. I've learned to trust those little impulses. I think any like welling up of joy or positive potential, I know to trust it now. And on the other hand, if I have a good idea, I go, oh, no, that's not, a good conceptual idea. I just think, no. My teacher, Doug Unger, told us once if a young writer could learn to distinguish between the things she thinks she should write and the things she should actually write, she could save about 25 years, But that when I have that feeling, and I had it at Tosca the other night, but although I don't know what for, but the way those sets were, they have a beautiful three-dimensionality to them, and there's just a little something rising up. And
you spoke about an intimation of an idea.
Yeah, or maybe the intimation of an intimation of an idea. But sometimes, there's this, for me anyway, there's a sense of... I really want to have an idea to which I can do justice. That's the first step. And sometimes you just sit there for a long time waiting for that to something in you goes, okay, we'll think about it, And then, but for me, what I've learned is don't go into that hallway. Stay out. Let the subconscious do that for a long, long time if it takes it. And then at some point it'll come out and then you can usher it out naturally as opposed to saying, yeah, what is that feeling? I better figure it out. I should make it something about the Trump era. That would be great. When I do that, I make big mistakes that cost me years. So it's a posture of kind of respectful, attentive waiting, like your date is coming downstairs and you'll know she'll be beautiful. So you just sit there. You don't go up the stairs, how's it going? You just,
That's good. When you wrote about Lincoln, were you writing about the man or the myth, do you think?
A myth that I was making up, essentially. Yeah, no, I mean, and I but also the, one of the terms and conditions that I granted to myself in order to write that book was to say, oh, no, you're not writing about Lincoln. Don't worry about it. You don't have to stress out over that. That would be insane. Just, you're not writing about Lincoln. You're going to have to...
It's been done before.
Oh, yeah. So much. But what I had to say to myself was, I promise you, it's not a book about Lincoln. Don't worry. And then it's sort of like Columbo, I'll learn one thing, sir. There might be a moment where he does come on stage. I hope that's okay. So that. yeah. But But that was part of the system of constraint that I had to construct to allow myself to do it, was to say it's not a book about Lincoln, it's not a book about grief, it's not a book about death. When you,
but it is a book about ghosts.
It's a book about all those things, but again, for me, I don't know if other writers feel this way, but I have to keep my some blinders on, just on the text. And if I do that, then all this stuff, like theme and all that, it'll come out. It's like they're like forest creatures, delicate forest creatures that will come out, but not if you look at them directly. So you know they're there, and you know that's why you're doing it. But if you concentrate on the technical parts in front of yourself, and for me also to concentrate on verisimilitude and trying to trick you into actually being in that fictive world, no matter how outlandish it is.
Trick.
Yeah. I think it's, yeah, it's a salesman. I feel like a salesman ethos, maybe from my dad. But, you know, that if you, we're going to play a game. I'm going to make an illusion. You're going to participate. And I'm going to make it, if I can, impossible for you to pull out of that fictive dream by any means necessary. That's sort of the beginning of the game that we're going to play. But if I do that, then the other things will
happen. And it's a game you want to feel part of, the way you felt part of it the other night at the opera.
Yes.
Where you have that moment where you are actually at one with what you're seeing.
Yes. And I think in...
And there's a fear also that it might not happen again.
Right. And in fiction, the former engineer in me says, okay, how do I do that? Well, one way is I get in as tight a communication as I can with my reader, and I imagine her as positively as I can. She's not stupid, she's not lazy, she's more worldly than me, she's kind, she's all these good things, and she's watching me like a hawk, you know? And I'm saying, once upon a time, and at every step, I think this is true, the reader watches you to see if you're being an honest player or not. Is the prose tight? You know, are you doing selfish repetitions? Are there logical flaws in the book that you've put in there because you couldn't figure out how not to do it? Those kind of cheap tricks. And my model is that every time you violate that intimacy contract, the reader moves a little bit away from you. So it's like you're in a motorcycle sidecar. Ideally, your helmets are bouncing against each other. You're so close because the writer hasn't made any mistakes of that type. Now, in a badly told story, the sidecar is about half a mile away, and you go around a corner and they don't hear about it for a week, you know? So I think that, for me, that's the model, and then it gives you a way to proceed all the time. I love you, dear reader, I respect you. Will you let me trick you lovingly? Oh, sure, of course, George, go ahead. But at the same time, you want there to be an honorable respect going on.
You know, what you described seems to me like a form of magic.
Yes. And I know you have a son who's a magician,
and so close-up magic,
yes.
The possibility of deception is something that interests me, particularly in the present political atmosphere we have in this country,
yeah.
Where you arrive at distracting. Magic, actually, is a very good tool for understanding how deception is possible,
yes.
Sleight of hand.
Yeah. But in magic and in writing, you consent to be deceived, you know.
Yeah.
And we do short-term relative deception in order to accomplish long-term transcendent truth.
Say that again.
Hmm?
Say that again.
That's Mike Tyson.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. No. Okay. But when you're in the White House briefing room, and somebody says, "Oh, look, that's a raccoon, but it's a cat," that is not a mutually agreed upon deception. That's just a good old-fashioned deception. So I think in this time especially, one of the things that's at risk is nuance. The intelligent nuance that says a novel is one kind of noble lying, a lie is a different kind of lying. It's lying, you know. And I think those of us who are, well, everybody should be protective of those nuances. But in writing, yeah, I think you're, I'm putting my arm around you and saying, let me tell you a story. You know, if I say, I'm going to tell you a story about this, a ghost, and this ghost story happened in this very room. Well, you know it didn't. But if you pretend that it did, we're going to have a beautiful time together. So I think that fiction works on that basis. And as a way to proceed, for me, the most useful thing has been to say, the reader is not down here. The reader's right up here with me. And any time I let her down, it's going to result in a flagging in the writing energy. And this can even happen on the phrase-to-phrase level, you know. If you say, you know, the cat jumped onto the black table, the ebony expanse, the dark-hued flatness. I think I've just lost my reader a little bit there, because she says, I get it, it's a black table, you know. And she says, why did you describe it three times? I think it's because you're showing off. That's a small fracture in our trust. And so I don't know whether this is objectively true, and I'm sure it's not true for other writers, but for me, it gives me a way to proceed. Even on the three word cluster, I know that I should be thinking of my reader as a honorable colleague.
Do you believe in ghosts?
Yeah, I do. No, I do. Yeah, I think so. I think so. When I was a kid, my grandfather passed away, and he, and the reason I believe this is because it's the only time it happened. I woke up, and he was at the foot of the bed, sort of a dark mass that I couldn't recognize, but I knew it was him. And what he was saying was, it's fine. We're good. And then that was it.
Do you know the story of Churchill and Lincoln's ghosts?
No.
It was in a BBC article. Soon after World War II, Winston Churchill was visiting the White House when he's said to have had an uncanny experience. Having had a long bath with a scotch and cigar, he reportedly walked into the adjoining bedroom only to be met by the ghost of Abraham Lincoln. Unflappable, even while completely naked, Churchill apparently announced, "Good evening, Mr. President. You seem to have me at a disadvantage." The spirit smiled and vanished.
Yeah. Pretty cool head. Although I can't quite get the image out of my head of Churchill naked with his
cigar.
That's probably why Lincoln vanished. I'd like to believe in ghosts, but I certainly believe in ghosts as a literary thing, because they're here. I mean, in other words, which of us sitting here doesn't have several dead people whispering lovingly or harshly in your ear, you know? And which of us doesn't sense ourselves as one of those people eventually? Again, in a terms of making a scientific view of the universe, you can't discount the dead. They don't disappear in any sense. They're in your neurons. So I think when I use them, it's mostly to say, if I just write a story in a realistic frame, I feel like I'm not quite telling the whole truth. You know, that we all carry dead people around with us, and we carry the prospect of our own death around with us. So that somehow has to be brought into play a little bit. You know, plus they're fun. They're fun. They're a riot. You know?
In reading your first book, Civil War Land in Bad Decline, I was reminded of a quotation by Borges, who said, "Looking back on it now, I have never strayed beyond my first book, Furor of Buenos Aires. I feel like all my subsequent writing has only developed themes first taken up there. I feel that all during my lifetime, I have been rewriting that one book." I wonder how much that applies to George Saunders.
100%. But the reason is,
I didn't think you would say 100%, but yes.
Yeah, well, 98. Yeah. Okay. No, but when I think what happened to me was when I wrote four or five books that didn't work. They were imitative and pretty dull. And then this thing I talked about earlier happened, and I went deep for the first time, and I figured out how it felt I should be writing. That is not a small thing. It's not the first time you do that. It's the only time you do it, in my view. You know, the time that you suddenly go, you inhabit yourself in a certain way, or you find your mode. It's very profound, and it's very, you don't repeat it. And especially if you're somebody like me, and my talent is such a narrow sliver. It's that basement talent, and I know that objectively. So that means you are going to be reworking that first moment again and again, kicking it to try to get it to give off a little more light, or carving off part of it and, you know, trying to expand it. And I think it was, for a while, I was sort of ashamed of that. And now I'm like, no, that's probably the game all of us play. Now, some of us have a bigger talent to start with. But to me, it's quite wonderful to say, well, I've got one brain, I've got one set of experience. It would be kind of strange if that, if I could express myself in multiple ways of equal intensity. That doesn't really make sense. The themes and stance of that first book was a carving out of territory, and then the rest of your career is kind of a moving around inside.
So it's a footnote to that in some way.
A footnote, or maybe a passing through it from a different direction. You know, you're trying to, you said it ineptly the first time, or in my case, I said it with, I think, I was focused on this recent realization that America was harsh. That was new to me. Why it was, I don't know. But I was kind of an optimistic kid, and oh, America is great. And I was kind of an Ayn Rand person in college,
yeah.
You know. So this was.
And you loved Ayn Rand.
I had an affair with her. You know. No, I didn't. No, I loved her in the way that people love her, which is, I think, a lot of people who are Ayn Rand fans are that at a moment in their life when they feel outgunned by something. Mm. So they resort
to
her.
You mentioned that earlier.
Yeah, yeah. But my first realization at that time was, wow, I'm a college-educated white guy with a nice family, and I'm suffering in this capitalistic environment. Whoa. You know, you look up and suddenly everything reformulates a little bit. So that book, and also I think it's easier to be dystopian. It's easier to be cynical, it's easier to find the negative resonances within something than it is to praise the positive. I think it's just technically harder. So the first book had that stance, and then I feel like ever since, I don't believe anything differently, but I'm bringing different skills to it and hopefully trying to not repeat, but to revisit that first energy burst, I guess.
A moment in Baldwin. I think Baldwin is part of the world that really, really matters to you. And it's in The White Man's Guilt, he writes the following: one wishes that Americans, white Americans, would read for their own sakes this record and stop defending themselves against it. Mm. Only then will they be enabled to change their lives. The fact that they have not yet been able to do this, to face their history, to change their lives, hideously menaces this country. Indeed, it menaces the entire world. White man, hear me. History, as nearly no one seems to know, is not merely something to be read, and it does not refer merely or even principally to the past. On the contrary, the great force of history comes from the fact that we carry it within us, and that unconsciously controlled by it in many ways, and history is literally present in all of us, that we do. It would scarcely be otherwise, since it is to history that we owe our frames of reference, our identities, and our aspirations. And it is with great pain and terror that one begins to realize this.
What a great writer. Wow, wow, yeah.
How right was he?
Yes, he was right. I mean, I think the writing this book made me realize certain things that I kind of knew but didn't actively know, and it's kind of an obvious truth. But we stole trillions of dollars of labor and never repaid it. We never actually changed the fundamental rules that applied during the slavery era. There's a new literature showing that for an African American working in those post-war years, it was just, as one book has it, slavery by another name. So in any system, the suppression of truth causes violence, and it causes denial energy and aggression. And I think I'm only starting to see in my own life that that's been true all along. I think we had a narrative that all was well and it had been put to rest, but I think those are facts. Those are facts, and kind of beautiful, or maybe sublime, to see our own violence explained that way. You know, you put violence into a system, it doesn't go away. It might move around a little bit, But the violence we injected into our country through that and also through our relation to the Native Americans is 100% alive, maybe even enhanced. And that is not, that is on white people to fix. Racism is a disease that we have. So it's not, it's not anyone else's problem. But again, I think it's in, there's a hopefulness in what Baldwin wrote, because if you are committed to truth and committed to looking at what's happening in your own mind and your own heart, then you can say, yeah, I'm a 59-year-old American. I was raised in a white supremacist culture that didn't even know it. Of course it's still in me, you know. But I can, like Chekhov, I can wring this surf out of myself. You can. It's not impossible. It can be done. It's almost, you know, I was thinking, you notice these things in yourself, and it's almost like if you look down and there's some shit on your shirt. You know, you don't say, well, I was raised that way. You know, you're terrified. You're sickened, and you try to get it off. So I think that's the attitude I'm trying to induce in myself, is look closely and see what remnants of racism and sexism and so on exist, and don't be afraid. It's okay. There's nothing to be afraid of except your own denial of those things. And like anything else in human psychology, it can be fixed. And as I said earlier, I think it can be fixed the most efficiently by turning to something bigger than yourself and saying, okay, what is the relation of this racism or this sexism or this homophobia? What's the relation of that to my God, if that's your thing? What does God think of racism? Then I think you can actually move along your trajectory in a hopeful way. I think traditionally I was at an event one time here in New York when there were two people of color talking about experiences of racism that they've had. And I noticed that the room was sort of guilty and sad and sick and passive. In other words, there was so much sadness being expressed that you couldn't deny. And among my fellow white people and in me, there was a lot of, oh God, I wish I wasn't white. You know, that feeling. Makes sense. But that is a position that is, in its passivity, is wrong.
What do you do beyond that?
I think you do the same thing as if you had the shit on your shirt. You know, you say, I have shit on my shirt. How can I fix it? I can take off the stupid shirt and wash it, you know. In other words, I think it's not that racism is a very mechanical, logical response to being raised in a white supremacist culture. It makes perfect sense that people feel as they do. But that also means it can be reversed by logical, and I would say by spiritual means. You know, I mean, I haven't written this out yet, but just the idea of a thought experiment. You are on an elevator. The door opens up. Somebody gets on. Okay, let's talk ourselves through this. Do you note the race of the person getting on? Yes or no? Okay. Whatever the answer is. All right. When you, and this goes for anybody of any race, when that person gets on, do you have projections about that person that are unsupported by facts? Are they positive or are they negative? Do you believe in them or do you recognize them as projections? Are you able to alter instantaneously your mind to recognize and out those projections? Now, if you go through that, I'm the engineer in me wants to make a point system somehow, you know. But I think that actually, for me, is an interesting way of looking at racism, because it certainly isn't an on-off thing. And I think one of the problems with that word is it becomes just a cudgel to hit somebody with. You are, you aren't, get thee to hell. But obviously, if we look into our own hearts, we can see that it's alive and dead in all different kinds of ways. And not only race, but I think anytime somebody's higher on the privilege ladder than somebody else, there's a system of projection that kicks in. If you're a straight person regarding a gay person, there's something like that. And the great American misunderstanding has been that we'll say, hello, gay person, I'm straight. Historically, we've been in charge. Let me give you some equality, you know? That's, you know, and we feel kind of good about it, and that's completely wrong. That's just homophobia of a different stripe. So I think for me, just to devise thought experiments, to do meditation and prayer, to say, of course I've got negative tendencies in me. I was raised in a culture that very purposely put them there. I don't like it. And I'm going to try to use my intelligence and my work ethic to expunge. You know, it's not easy, and I'm not sure it's, you know, but I think it's possible. And that's the only hopeful way forward, is to say, yeah, we got a problem. We've got shit on our shirts. Oh, my gosh, you know.
You were saying to me that at this moment, you are beginning again to write short stories.
One short story, yeah.
And you also said to me that you were wondering whether you could carry this passion forward, whether you could reboot in some way the kind of passion you had formerly. And I'm wondering, is that a way for you to look back and think of the earliest work you wrote, a way of getting back to that kind of undiluted passion you speak about?
Yeah, I think that, you know, as you get older and as you do more, you have to be good at taking the passion in whatever form it appears. So when the first book came, it was really, I was working at an engineering company, riding my bike to work every day. We only had one car. We were broke, and I could see that the world, not only did it not want me to write, it would prefer that I quit. And there was a real urgency, and it was very pragmatic. Like, I've got to get something out soon that is so weird that the world can't ignore it. That was part of it. So now, and there was an ambition, and a kind of a desperate ambition that I don't really feel anymore. And there was also a lot of kind of rage about the system at that point that I don't exactly feel now. I'm kind of experiencing that old person thing where if something terrible goes out of your life, you assume that it doesn't exist anywhere else, you know. Well, it's weird. Nobody gets high anymore. You know, that, yeah. So, but I think one of the things we have to do is say, okay, well, that particular flavor of passion is a 32-year-old passion. I'm 59. Let's see what other passions arrive. And I love, speaking of Twain, you know, he said that thing about the well, in writing a book, the well empties, and you have to wait for the well to fill up again. So that's kind of where I am now. And one of the ways I do it is by trying to, well, one is to withdraw from the cycle of promotion that you get into necessarily of a book and say, I want to be...
A recluse?
Sorry?
A recluse?
Not a recluse, but a mental recluse. I want to, if I go somewhere, I want to go there because I want to see it. You know, I don't...
With fresh eyes.
I'm sorry.
With fresh eyes.
Yes, and just a kind of that curiosity that comes up naturally. But that it's happening already. I can feel it. And the opera was very helpful, actually. You know, to go and see Beauty Made, it just does something that gets you sort of antsy again. So I'm pretty confident I'll be, you know, hopefully still writing at 400 years old and die doing a heroic rescue, and that will be it. You know, this.
George Saunders, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Paul. What a pleasure.